This is where we left off from the last lecture, the cardiac action potential. There are two cell types. There's contractile cells, autorhythmic cells. Which AP is this? Contractile or autorhythmic? This is contractile. So we have yet to talk about autorhythmic in detail. I mean, I kind of introduced it. But before we do that, one of the things is to discuss a comparison between the cardiac muscle, this AP, and contrast it with skeletal muscle AP. Okay, it's one of the things that's commonly done in physiology here. And so I have these graphs here, and we have to remember some of the things we talked about in skeletal muscle. We studied the muscle twitch. Okay, for those of you that don't remember, let me remind you. Here's a twitch. The muscle twitch is skeletal muscle's response to one action potential. Okay, that's what we taught you in 4.3. So what we're doing is we're going to compare. Let me get my points out. Muscle twitch is a singular response to one action potential. You stimulate the cell one time and see what the muscle cell does. So that's what I'm writing here. A single response to one action potential. Boom, that's what the picture shows. And this is skeletal muscle. This is not cardiac muscle. We're going to compare the two. Now, I would say the things that you have to keep track of on this graph is a little confusing. There's like a few things. Okay, one is, there's three things. You see the red curve. That is the action potential. Okay, that's the red curve. Pay attention to that. It's like the membrane potential. So I'll just put AP. That's in red. You see that. One thing to keep track of is its duration. How long is it? These are very quick. These are in milliseconds. Keep track of the refractory period. See how they tell you what the refractory period is in this kind of beige area? How long is the refractory period? Okay, keep track of that. Let's recall what that is actually. You know, a refractory period is a period of insensitivity. A period of insensitivity. So that being said, if you have an action potential and you're in the refractory period, you're within it, within these first 10 milliseconds. If you're within the refractory period, can you achieve another action potential? Yes or no? Well, the no's have it. That's correct. Okay, no. Maybe they didn't understand the question. See the red thing? You got an action potential. And I'm asking you, can you re-stimulate and get another one? And the answer is no. Not if you're in the refractory period. Okay, that's the thing. It's a period of insensitivity. So when you're within the refractory period, maybe you should note that. Can't re-stimulate. So let's remember what this graph is. You have like a muscle cell and you're shocking it. Do you see the little triangle there at time zero? That's when the physiologist like hit the zap button and gave it a jolt and caused an action potential to fire. And the refractory period is about the same duration as the action potential, because once you get an action potential, you can't get another one. Just the cell channels, you gotta wait for them to close and all that stuff. You gotta wait for the voltage-gated channels to reset. Here's the thing though, so when you stimulate the muscle with an action potential, you get a twitch. But look how long it takes for the twitch, the contraction duration, to completely contract, get a peak tension, and then completely relax. So keep track of that as well. That's the blue curve, contraction duration. So you have the action potential duration, the contraction duration, and the refractory period. And let's just kind of like write it all out. So like for skeletal muscle, the action potential duration, it's about 10 milliseconds. And about how long is the refractory period? It's about 10. Do you see that? Okay, before I move on, everyone has to see this, otherwise I'm just, words coming out of my mouth is pointless. Is there any questions on this point? Do you see that the refractory period is about as long as the action potential? You just can't re-stimulate once you already got an action potential. You can't get double action potential on the same cell at the same time. Can't do it. And that's all we're saying here. Look at the contraction duration. It's very long. It's almost like when you completely relax, 100. Now, the people who write these books, they're trying to show this to students for a reason. And let me tell you the reason by asking you a question. Do you remember muscle tetanus? The question is tetany possible? Well, first of all, you can only answer the question if you remember what tetanus is. And it's really, because this twitch response stuff is great, but when you feel your muscles twitching, is that a normal response? That's really abnormal. Something's wrong. This is just a lab phenomenon. Tetanus is how muscle works in your body, for real. But this is just kind of a physiologist trying to investigate to see what a single response looks like. In the skeletal muscle, I'm going to show you the next slide so you can answer the question. Here's the next slide. And I'm asking the same question again. The answer's here. For those of you that remember what tetanus is it a yes or a no? So say no. The answer is yes. Let me explain why. Tetanus is a smooth maximum tension achieved by the muscle with repeated stimulations. Now at first, you don't achieve it. See this herky-jerky stuff? Now do you see each, what they're doing in the lab? It's like, think about this, you're a muscle physiologist. And nobody knows how muscle works. And you want to figure out why. That's your life's passion. So you have to get a model, you have to like set it up, and you're saying, okay, the first question you ask is, well, how does it work if I just zap the thing one time? That's the twitch response. Okay, that's interesting. What happens if I keep zapping it? Okay. Now, what they're doing is, he's gonna set his amplifier to re-stimulate every 75 milliseconds, and he wants to see what happens. Now, what he knows is he can't re-stimulate in the first 10 milliseconds, but what he says to himself is, okay, I can't re-stimulate here, but I can re-stimulate here at 75, right? Because I'm outside of the refractory period, And look, what's tension here? Is it zero or not zero? It's not zero. He's going to zap this thing before the muscle has time to completely relax, and he wants to see what happens with the tension that's generated by the muscle. And this is what it looks like. And every 75 milliseconds, he zaps it. And what happens? Is tension increased or decreased? It's increased more, more, more. He's like, wow, it just keeps getting more. Is this going to go to infinity? No, it levels off. Okay, what do we call this max tension here? It's on the board. Tetanus. Tetanus. So, I'm going to ask the question again. Is tetanus possible?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. So, you know, I know it's been a while since you studied 430, so information was foggy. But it's important to appreciate that, because now I want you to look at the same experiment with cardiac muscle. And we get these graphs, same experiment, different graphs. So let's look at the twitch response for cardiac muscle. Now let's remember that the action potential is quite different. Remember that thing called plateau? Now the plateau is, what's shown here? This kind of flat part which stays on. Okay, anyways, let's kind of get the same data here. And let's take, the data for the same stuff. Now, how long is the AP duration for a cardiac muscle cell? It's pretty long. I mean, it's almost 250, right? Hopefully you see that right on the board. Let's see if you're awake this morning. So is that longer or shorter than the skeletal muscle?
Longer.
Now that was an easy question, right? This number is bigger than that one. Okay, now look at the refractory period. About how long is that?
The same.
About the same, maybe a little shorter. It's about the same. We'll just make it easy and say it's 250. Just the ballpark. Okay, what about contraction duration? The whole peak and then completely relaxed back to zero. How long is that? Well, it's not quite 250. Maybe it's a little longer. Maybe 260 or something. I don't know. The point is, it's almost as long. Let's see here. I'll just call it 260. It's a little longer. Okay. Okay, so before I move on, let's kind of like look at the biggest difference here. I mean, isn't the biggest difference between this kind of muscle and that kind of muscle, these first two things here? It's like the refractory period is much longer. Now in your head, does that make sense? Why would it be much longer? Because the action potential is much longer. You know, if you're a cell and you're in a state of extended depolarization, you can't re-depolarize. You just can't. The voltage-gated sodium channels, they have to reset, okay, and go back to the rest state. But they can't do that if the membrane potential is depolarized. They just can't. So as long as the action potential is happening, the cell is in a state of refractory period. So that's why these two kind of go hand in hand. The refractory period is going to be about the same length as the duration of the action potential. Now that has significant consequences when you actually can re-stimulate the cardiac muscle. Because your heart has a maximum heart rate, okay? Now the easy way to figure out what your max heart rate is, just based on your age, take 220 and subtract your age. What number do you get? 220 minus your age. Do it. 200? Mine's like 175, and you become a little older than you. That's your max heart rate. Your heart can only beat so fast. But the point is, every time that your heart contracts, it needs to relax, right? So that way it can refill with blood for the next cardiac cycle, okay? Now here's the point I'm trying to make. Here's the next experiment where you try to zap this thing every 75 milliseconds. So what we know is, can you re-stimulate here?
No.
No. Or here? No. 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 In fact, the first time you can re-stimulate is here. Now, does that make sense? Because you're outside the refractory period, right? Now, look how much time the muscle cell has had time to relax. It almost relaxes completely. So what this does is, well, let's first answer the question, is tetany possible, yes or no?
No.
Right, the no is correct. And this is really the whole point of this part of the lecture. So the reason why that's so important is because if tetany was possible, what would tetany look like in your ventricles in a constant state of contraction? It would be constantly squeezed. If it just stayed squeezed, squeeze the word, if you just kind of crushed it because you're in tetany, could you refill that? You couldn't, okay? So it's very important for cardiac muscle to always have a diastole so it can relax and then refill. That's why tetany is not possible, okay? It's not supposed to work that way. You need to allow time for it. So let me write this out, the kind of logic that follows. I'm going to erase this out. But I'll leave this important point, the yes-no. Let me look at my notes. There's a particular way I want to phrase the logic here. So the train of thought from the data we just went through is, the first thing is, you had a longer AP duration in cardiac muscle. So as a consequence of that, you had a longer refractory period, didn't you? Therefore, what I'm writing is therefore cardiac muscle has a longer refractory period, a period of insensitivity where you cannot re-stimulate. That's what's being shown here. So what this allows is that the muscle has more time to relax. That's what you're seeing here, because you can't re-stimulate. You're not getting this wave summation in tetany. So as a result of this, it can't be re-stimulated. Cardiac muscle has time to relax. It allows for diastole. When the muscle has time to relax, think of that as diastole, and the ventricles will have time to fill with blood. So I'll put diastole in parentheses, ventricles. Have time to fill with blood. You're allowing that relaxation. So pressure in the ventricles can drop almost to zero. That'll allow them to refill with the blood with each diastole. You can't re-stimulate, okay? You can increase your heart rate, but even if you have a max heart rate, there's still always a period of systole and diastole. So that's kind of the train of thought. It's like I'm trying to think for you. It's like I go through this, like, what do I really want students to know? That's it, okay? So like to answer this question, how does a longer absolute refractory period prevent tetany? That's the reasoning, okay? So ask yourself that question and then answer it. Just read your notes. And eventually something will click if it's not clicking right now. Okay. So I'll just kind of tag on. Tetany is not possible. Tetany is like there's just systole. There's no diastole. That's not possible in the heart. Well, if it is, you're dead. The closest that the heart comes to that is called ventricular fibrillation, where the chambers, the signal can't spread. And I've been told that, I've never felt it myself, if you have that person's heart in your hand, they're in VFib, it feels like a writhing bag of worms. Okay? There's no cardiac output. If you're in VFib, there's no cardiac output. So how's the blood going to circulate? It's not. You'll be in shock in a matter of minutes. You can go in shock and faint anyways. I was at the coroner's office where they're doing a dissection. There's a student, paramedics. One guy just passed out. I just heard a thud. The guy was on the floor. He was okay, thankfully. But it happened. You just pass out with your heart working. Now, to make sure you're okay with this, I'm going to show you the same kind of data. Let's kind of do it together as a class. Write down the right answer. Go home and quiz yourself. Which one's the cardiac muscle? Data set. Hey, top and bottom, A or B. What do you think? Just by staring at the curves a little bit. It's B. B is good. Yeah, right. It's another one. Okay, I know it's hard to read here. Approximate how long the absolute refractory period is each for the cardiac and skeletal muscle. So I'm just asking you about the absolute refractory period, the period of insensitivity. I know it's hard to see because it's like, you have to probably look at it at home and it projects better. But you should know just based on the ballpark numbers I have here. What's the refractory period for cardiac and for skeletal muscle based on these choices? People are saying D, and that is correct. This figure has it at about 200. We had it at about 250. But the point is it's much longer than skeletal muscle. So D is correct. Mark that. Think about that if you're not quite getting that. Next question, which muscle type has a longer, oh, I just answered it. Okay, cardiac, okay. Oh yeah, okay, so before I move on, students are asking me about the written part of the exam. So let me just go through it. I wanted to wait till I taught this to say that this is gonna be a written question. Okay, this, the whole data I just went through. So let me write it as a topic. Written topics. So this stuff, I'll call it comparison of cardiac and skeletal muscle. That's one. So again, these are just the written topics. I'll ask you about the cardiac cycle. Big surprise there. One way I'll do it is to ask about that, what I call the Wiggers diagram. That's the one where you plot the pressure against the time and then the volume against the time. Okay. But the other way I taught the cardiac cycle is when you plot the volume against the pressure, and I call that the pressure volume curve. This exam, these questions, they're really just more like fill in the blank and then short answer response. It's not a true essay like lecture exam 2 is. I said, write about this, and you spend a couple of pages. This is not that. This is more like the first exam. Remember the first exam? It was kind of like just short response. This is formatted more like that. So these two things. Surely you haven't forgotten today's quiz. I ask a lot of questions like that, okay? So, before I move on, any questions on that? Yeah? I'm choosing all of them.
Oh, okay. You mean for the cardiac cycle?
Both.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, I know some instructors, well, I'll choose from this. I already wrote the test, it's all on there. I mean, if I said I'm only gonna choose one, would you only study one? You just flip a coin? I hope the other ones you study both anyway, right? So yeah. Some details about the autorhythmic cells, about their action potential. These are the cells of the SA node and the AV node. Just to remind you, I mean, we already talked about this. These are the cells that have the spontaneous depolarization. What I said earlier is they self-generate action potentials. This is why the heart does not require innervation. It has innervation, but it doesn't need it because it has its own intrinsic pacemakers. And if you study the action potential of these cells, we talked about this before, we have the pacemaker potential and the action potential. This cell type has a threshold. So call this autorhythmic cells, APs. Autorhythmic cells. There is a threshold. This is a potential, so millivolts. The dotted line is my threshold potential. They put it at about negative 40. Okay, when you reach that threshold potential, you get an action potential. That's our threshold potential. Now, so leading up to the threshold potential, you have a pacemaker potential. So I'm just going to draw just the pacemaker potential. Okay? They have rest at about minus 60. Let me put that first. So minus 60 is rest. Threshold, THR, is minus 40. Start at rest. How about I use, orange. Okay. And you just kind of slowly depolarize the threshold. You don't stay at rest. In fact, there is no rest because You're never at minus 60 except for a singular point. Okay? I think I said that earlier. There's no resting membrane potentials because as soon as you reach rest, you depolarize to threshold. So this is what we call the pacemaker potential, just this line. Pacemaker POT. It's a slow depolarization to threshold. Remember, we call those the funny currents. That's how I'll define pacemaker potential. A slow depolarization to threshold. When physiologists first studied this, they thought it was funny. They called them funny currents. Okay? I used that term before. Now, a depolarization is typically carried by a positive cation influx, and we know now we think it's sodium. So this is a sodium current, carried by sodium. And the channels that carry these funny currents are either called the funny channels or HCN channels. Write that down, funny channels. Another term I use on tests, HCN. The H stands for hyperpolarization. These channels are activated when the cell is hyperpolarized. So I'm going to write that down. So they open when these cells are hyperpolarized. Makes sense to me. You get very negative. Negative 60, they open. The cell being in a state of negativity opens the channels, and they just kind of slowly rise to threshold, then you get an action potential. So before I show you action potential, is there any questions on the HCN channels or the funny currents? This is what I hope you see, is that when these cells fire an action potential, that's a heartbeat, okay? Every time you see an ECG, like in your subject, the ECG was started by an action potential in these cells. Of which node? The SA node. Could be the AV if something's wrong with the SA. Remember how I said the pacemaker thing works? We have three pacemakers. We have SA, we have AV, and what's the third one?
Kinji,
very good. How it works is the big dog rules. The strongest one commands the heart. So what's the strongest one? SA. No, let's say SA, some trauma or drugs or whatever, it doesn't work. Which one will take over? Then AV. Let's say you have something wrong with SA and AV, or maybe you have complete heart block. Then what takes over? Purkinje, okay? You probably need a pacemaker because Purkinjes are not very reliable. All right, well, anyways, you reach threshold. Okay, that's this first graph here. The middle graph shows you the ions. What does it say? Net sodium in. Okay, that kind of gets you to threshold. The third one shows you the channels. That says IF. IF is funny currents, or funny channels. Funny current channels open. If you haven't taken physics, the symbol I means current. The subscript F means the funny currents. Okay. So when you study the figure, IF equals funny currents. So let's talk about the action potential. The depolarization is not due to sodium, it's due to calcium. Okay. So the depolarization and the repolarization represent the two phases of the action potential in this cell type. There's no plateau. So I'm going to use red for polarization. It depolarizes all the way, well, in this figure it says about plus 20. And the depolarization is due to calcium, not sodium. So in naming this, call it action potential, not pacemaker potential. I'm just going to write dipole, and I'll put calcium in parentheses. The depolarization is due to calcium. When those fast calcium channels, when they close, when those channels close, the potassium channels open, and you have a potassium efflux. So how about blue? Repolarizes all the way back to minus 60. So the repole is due to a potassium efflux. Potassium leaves the cell, that repolarizes the membrane potential back to rest. Now here's the thing, as soon as you hyperpolarize, are you going to stay at rest?
No.
What channels open when you get to negative 60 again?
Sodium.
Yeah, those HCN channels, let the sodium in. And you'll not really stay at rest. They stay there, you know, you just kind of and you fire again, causing another cardiac cycle. Okay, you get another depolarization, followed by another repolarization. So what we have here is, that's our AP, okay? But what we also have here that we don't see anywhere else, what is the orange line again? What do we call that? The pacemaker potential. Yeah. So you got action potential, you got pacemaker potential. That's really all you got to know. Not much more to it than that. This picture is from the Marriott textbook. It is the same information. I just thought I'd show you two different kinds of the same thing. And what I thought would be good to do is to kind of go through and kind of compare the contractile cell with the autorhythmic cell. And as you study, I think you'll notice that we're making a lot of comparisons, aren't we? This comparison is comparing the AP of the two cell types within the heart. But what comparison that also did I make this morning, the start? I compare what two kinds of muscle?
Cardiac
and skeletal. And I think every once in a while there's a student that they kind of cram and they forget what they're comparing. And it comes across on the test. So let's remember what we're comparing. Here we're comparing two APs. But we just got through comparing two kinds of muscle. So those are two different topics. So let's keep track of what we're comparing and I think you'll be okay. Let's do this. Let's compare contractile cell, autorhythmic cell. Let's see, I just kind of write right on that PowerPoint slide. So we have contractile cells there, autorhythmic cells there. So I'm just kind of right on here. Which of those cells, or maybe both did, which header did both have a pacemaker potential? Autorhythmic did, I just got through mentioning it. Did contractile cells have a pacemaker potential?
No.
No, they don't need one. Okay. I mean, how do they get depolarized? Remember all the gap junctions in the intercalated discs? They're just going to get theirs. They can be at rest. They'll just go straight to depolarization because of the gap junctions, right? As long as the SA node keeps firing, the whole heart is a syncytium. The whole thing's gonna spread, starting at the SA node, spread through the whole heart, which I talked about. Okay, so I'm gonna just put like, you know, I'll put yes for autorhythmic, and then, you know, no. Okay, now for depolarization, they both had depolarization. Now here's the difference. What ion was the depolarization in the contractile cells? Was it sodium, was it calcium, was it potassium? What was it?
Sodium.
It was sodium. That carried the depolarization for the contractile cells. Sodium. What was it, what is it for autorhythmic?
Calcium.
It's calcium. So there's that difference there. Plateau. Did both have a plateau?
No.
Only one did. Now which one was it?
Contractile.
The contractile did have a plateau. Do we remember like kind of how that happened?
Calcium.
Yeah, calcium. There's a calcium surge, potassium plug. Might want to review your notes for that. So I'll put yes, no for this. The contractile cells, yes, they have a plateau. The autorhythmic cells, no, they don't. Okay, now, repolarization. They both had it. What ion is responsible for repolarization for both?
Potassium.
Potassium is. So I'm going to write potassium in both columns. Now I put tension here. Only one of these cell types can actually have the striations and can actually generate tension. Which one is it?
Contractile.
Okay, so I'll put yes, no for that. Yes for that guy. Okay, I'm gonna move on to, unless there's some questions about what we did here. Well, let's kind of talk about the this a little bit more. You know, we can modify this. The autonomic nervous system can kind of increase your heart rate or decrease your heart rate. Now, what did you do in the lab that accelerated it? What did your subject do? It was segment 3. It was exercise, right? That elevated the heart rate. But you knew that even if you don't exercise, right? We call it the accelerator and the brakes. And, well, maybe I should leave this up here. Here's a picture of the autonomic nervous innervation to the heart. Now remember, the heart doesn't require innervation, but we can modify it. Okay. It can still beat even if these nerves are ripped out because of the SA node. We can modify the rhythm. So what I wrote is, autonomic nerves can modify the heart rate. What we teach in 4.3 is that this nervous system has two divisions, sympathetic, parasympathetic. Well, if we call sympathetic the accelerator, that can cause an increase in the heart rate, say if resting heart rate is 75. Okay, when we did the lab in a class full of young people, for the most part, usually the resting heart rate's around 60. Did any of you guys see a heart rate of resting heart rate of 50 in the 50s? Yeah, I'm sure some of you did. Okay. The point is, if you accelerate the heart rate, that's called a tachycardia. Parasympathetic has the opposite effects. that's the brakes. If you slow down the heart rate, that's called the bradycardia. If resting heart rate was like 60 or 70, bradycardia would be like 40. Now, you should have seen that when the subject was lying down and resting, but you don't see it too well because it's just, this is a stressful environment. It's not like you're home on your couch, right? But you know, just relaxing in a peaceful environment is bradycardia. It's the parasympathetic response. And in physiology class, we like to teach you the cell mechanism, why one speeds it up, one slows it down. So here are the effects of the brakes, the parasympathetic activity. Let's first analyze the picture. To see a contrast, study the top, normal, seated, you know, basically being seated and monitoring your pulse in a state of rest, that's kind of the baseline, whatever it is. In this case, you see where it says BPM? 75, that's your textbook average. Do you see that? Well, you tell me, which kind of AP is this, contractile or autorhythmic?
Autorhythmic, yeah.
Here's minus 60, here's threshold, okay? Do you see how they purple out, like the hyperpolarization? I kind of like that. Let's see, what else are you supposed to do? So I think that's pretty good. They say pre-potential spontaneous depolarization. So they use a bit of a different term than I use. They say pre-potential. What did I call it? Pacemaker potential. Same difference. Pre-potential means like before the action potential. Okay. But it's setting the pace. So at this pace, the person's heart rate is 75. If you want to slow it down, here's the effect of acetylcholine on heart rate. Here's the difference. You see how it's purpled out? But see how it's like purpled out more? You've done a couple of things. One, you've increased the hyperpolarization. Two, you have a slower depolarization. So these are the effects of acetylcholine on the heart. I'm going to write this down. Effects of ACH. Because let's remember that ACH, that's the neurotransmitter of this thing, this system. You're affecting the SA and the AB node, basically. And we should kind of name the nerve. Vagus. You guys remember your cranial nerves? I was having a student at the dissection ID that nerve. They're trying to remember which one. And I'm like, count to 10. Now, why did I say that? Vagus nerve is cranial nerve 10. You remember that? So let's know vagus nerve for this test, okay? In how it affects the heart. It basically was shown on the previous slide. On this figure, you see the purple nerve? The purple nerve is basically gonna be the vagus nerve. At the top, it says the dorsal motor nucleus of vagus. And the purple is the parasympathetic fibers. And they even show you where it innervates. Boom, boom, SAAV node. Okay, so make that connection. This is the brakes. So I said there's two things. You increase the hyperpolarization and you make the depolarization, the threshold, slower. Okay, so that's effect number one, increase hyperpolarization. Let me write that down. So to modify this picture for me, I have to increase my bottom line here. Show it a little bit better. Let's pretend I'm going to modify this regular heart rate. I'm going to like slow it down. One thing, I increase hyperpolarization, meaning that as I go down, I extend the blue line a little farther. Right? That's increased hyperpolarization. The way you can do that is you open more potassium channels, right? Any questions on that? So do you see how when you do that, now you're further away from threshold? Further from threshold. The other thing you do is you have a slower depolarization, okay? Not only are you further away from threshold, you're going to depolarize slower. Essentially, what you're doing is you're closing calcium channels. You're closing some calcium channels. So what that does is, I use my orange, and it's like, so it's like, instead of, number one, I'm starting from farther away from threshold, but number two, it's like, I'm gonna take longer to get to threshold, okay? So number one, you're further away from threshold, number two, it takes longer to reach threshold. Write that down. Okay, I'm gonna move on. Any questions on the brakes? That's kind of what's shown here. You're starting from farther away, and the slope of this is decreased. It's like you're decreasing the slope. It's like you're taking this slope and you're going. It was kind of hard to draw, but it's like you're kind of like decreasing the slope for number two. You're not increasing the slope, more steep. You're decreasing slope. That's another way people use to describe the number two part. Decrease slope. Take longer to reach threshold. Decrease slope. I guess the opposite would be increase the slope. You reach threshold faster. Students have trouble with the word slope. Maybe it's been like, you know, you learn about slope in geometry. It's like, you maybe forget that. We're using that word here because it's like the steepness of the slope determines when you reach threshold. So I guess that's a term you should kind of star if you've forgotten about slope and all that stuff. Let's talk about the accelerator then. No question. Okay, here's the accelerator. So let me erase this. Hold on. Show you the different one here. I'll erase this. So here's the effect of tachycardia. You produce shorter action potentials. You start from a less negative potential, requires less time to reach threshold. So everything's reversed. So the first point they say is, well, start from less negative potential. You have a reduced repolarization. That's what they're showing you here. Reduce, repole. I guess I say it one way. You start from a less negative potential. You're actually starting. You're closer to threshold. That's where you start. Instead of starting further away from threshold, you're starting closer to it in this reduced repolarization. So the reason for that is the effect of catecholamines, you're opening the funny channels sooner. So let's remember, the parasympathetic used acetylcholine, but for the sympathetic, it's not acetylcholine. It's the catecholamines, which are epinorepi. So these are effects of epinorepi, what we learned about in biology in this class, but the endocrine exam. So the second thing that it says there is, you start from a less negative potential, requires less time to reach threshold, okay? Because what you're doing is, you're not decreasing the slope, you're increasing the slope. Kind of hard to see there. You're gonna open calcium channels more. So when you open more calcium channels, what that does is you increase the slope and you reach threshold quicker. Increase slope. Reach threshold faster. So you're reaching threshold faster for two reasons. One, you don't repolarize as much. Two, when you start to go back up, you go back at a steeper slope. You increase the slope, not decrease the slope. So let me show you what that is. It shows you there. I mean, if this is rest, kind of a normal resting heart rate, what they're saying is, if I would draw like right over it, stop right there. Let's say catecholamines are taking effect right there where I stopped. Do you see where I stopped? I didn't repolarize as much. I reduced it. That's number one. Okay. I don't go all the way down here. I stop before that. The second thing is I don't use the same slope. I increase it, so this kind of moves up a little bit. So I'm gonna go like this, like that. And I reach threshold much quicker. So you get something like that effect, and that's what's kind of shown on the board there. So some details there, I don't want you to remember, oh, it speeds it up, it slows it down. We have to talk about the cell physiology here. But to ask a very basic question, to show you all three on one frame, which one is just the regular normal sinus rhythm? A. Now when you modify it, what does sympathetic show? Which frame? C is correct. Therefore, parasympathetic bradycardia is shown in B. Okay, but know the mechanisms. Know the mechanisms. Don't just recognize accelerated or brakes. All right, let's take a break. When we come back, we'll do cardiac output and some calculations we might have to do for the exam.